Thank you, Gail, for that sweet, sweet blessing. Psalm 58 was, Psalm 56 was perfectly inspired by God, using the psalmist David. After David was being pursued aggressively to end his life, God, the God of David, delivered him, and now in Psalm 56, David offers a word of praise and thanksgiving for who God is. And in this day and age of our own, where we are being pursued by Satan himself as believers, this is also a good word of encouragement to us, because the God of David is the God of us believers today. So hear this word of encouragement from Psalm 56, beginning with verse 8. You have taken account of my wanderings, put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book? Then my enemies will turn back in the day when I call. This I know, that God is for me. In God, whose word I praise, in the Lord, whose word I praise, in God I have put my trust, I shall not be afraid. What can man do to me? Your vows are binding upon me, O God. I will render thank offerings to you, for you have delivered my soul from death, indeed my feet from stumbling, so that I may walk before God in the light of the living. Will you stand and sing with me unto the Lord, 217, Holy, Holy. Shall we stand and sing together? Thank you. Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be able to sing a wonderful, simple song of praise unto you that you alone so richly deserve. Hallelujah. As we come in your holy presence, we welcome your presence here today, Father. Thank you for knowing us just as we are, for loving us just as we are. Especially do we thank you for Jesus Christ, our one and only living Savior, in whose name we gladly pray together, and all of God's people joined and said together, Amen. All right, thank you. Please be seated. Well, someone sitting around you needs to be shaken up. So would you turn and just give them a good old friendly handshake, please. Please sign the friendship pads on the end of the pew and pass it along. Check out the names of the folks sitting with you. Now, in the one insert, the other insert about praying for our nation, I'll talk about in a few minutes, but the insert about our covered dish supper, we hope that you'll come to it. It is on a Wednesday night, and we just think if you're working, it'll be a nice thing to come to. It's free. It's the four F's. It's free, it's fun, it's fellowship, and it's food. So we're going to have a good time together. Now, I just want to clarify, it is the night we're starting our Bible study. We're mainly having dinner, but I will be introducing our Bible study. So don't let the Bible study part keep you away from the dinner. We want you to come for dinner so we have all the fellowship. But we'll also be introducing, and it won't take long for the introduction. And then after that, the following week, we'll actually start it. Now, what we're doing is, the title of the study is, What on Earth is Going On? People are asking me that question. They're asking others that question. With the terrorism and the violence and the shootings and these natural storms, what on earth is going on with all this? And if you read and know Matthew chapter 24 and Matthew chapter 25 and the letter of Jude, it will explain clearly what's going on. And if you know it, you might be upset, you might be disturbed, you might be concerned, but you're not going to be shocked. Because what's going on is exactly what God said would go on. So it's not going to be no date setting. It's not going to be depressing. It's going to be encouraging. It's not going to be alarming. It's going to be soothing type of study. So that's on Wednesday nights. But we start with dinner. And please sign up and bring some good food. Because I'm hungry already and I just want it. All right, those are all the announcements I need to make. At this time, we'll worship the Lord by giving unto him our gifts, our tithes, and our offering. Shall we stand and sing our doxology together, please? Praise you, Heavenly Father, for these gifts which are presented to you. We thank you for allowing us to do that, for calling us to do this. We present them to you in the loving name of Jesus Christ, and all believers joined and said together, Amen. Now, as we go to prayer together, I want to draw your attention, please, to that other insert about praying for our nation. And I'm asking our church family to do this every night, wherever you are, at 9 o'clock. Would you stop whatever you're doing for 1 minute and pray for America? And there's a list of suggested prayer requests on that insert, but you can see how that began from World War II when Winston Churchill called for the people of England to pray every night when Big Ben chimed the 9 o'clock hour. It took 1 minute for Big Ben to ring 9 bells, and collectively the people of England prayed for England during World War II, and it was after that that the war began to change in favor of England. Now, some of the critics say, well, that was just by luck or coincidence, but we believe it was God's hand of intervention. And so the grassroots movement of conservative and evangelical and fundamental Christians like us all across America are beginning to follow that example. And so all across America, regardless of the time zone, at 9 o'clock every night, we Americans, Christian Americans, are going to pray for the well-being of America. So it's between you and the Lord, and I'm not going to call, nobody's going to call you, we're not asking to sign up. Just pray for America, 9 o'clock every night. Now, some of the names on our prayer list all of them need our prayerful consideration, but this Wednesday, Walt Kennerup Sr., Cindy's husband, is going to undergo another heart procedure at Cooper Hospital this Wednesday. And then Gene Marley is in the Voorhees Assisted Living Facility. Jim Cutler needs prayer support, as does Courtney Green, who is Bob and Cheryl Green's 21-year-old granddaughter, who needs a heart transplant, as the Lord enables that to happen. Madison Menser, Amy Julian, and Jean Ireton, Jamie Hosford, Amy Dow, George Pearson Jr., all need our prayer support. And when the other names are not mentioned, that doesn't mean they're not important, but would you pray for these folks as well as the others? Now, our missionary for the week is Ranch Hope. This is a holiday weekend. Ranch Hope, Dave Bailey in Alloway, New Jersey. That's a residential program for teenage boys who are become incorrigible at home or they're in trouble with the law. And rather than sending them to jail, this is a residential program where they're there 24/7, they're educated there, they're housed there, they're fed there, they're clothed there, but all in a Christ-centered atmosphere. And so we're glad to support them financially. All the staff members, this is a holiday weekend, those boys and the staff members are not home. So that's why we use the holiday time to especially pray for this ministry. Let's go to prayer together, and you pray silently for a few moments, and then I'll ask you to join me in prayer. May we pray together. Gracious Father, we lift up our voices now in concert, and we're unified at your throne of grace. Thank you for allowing us to pray individually, but now as we collectively come as a church family at your throne of grace, we know that you're pleased whenever believers come and pray in obedience to your word, in accordance to your will, in the loving, living name of Jesus Christ. We're so glad, Heavenly Father, that whenever we confess and repent of our sins, you gladly and graciously respond to our confession and repentance with fresh cleansing and renewal. May we be reminded, Father, that there is no sin in our lives that we can hide from you. But neither is there any sin in our lives that you will not cleanse as we confess and repent of it. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for the power of prayer and for answered prayer. Refresh every heart, every mind here today that you do answer prayer, which is according to your word and your will for our lives. Father, we pray for these who are going through a time of heartache and sorrow and loneliness, difficulty of all manner. We thank you, Father, that your desire is to heal, your desire is to bring people to repentance and salvation. Your desire is to work your miracles in their lives, and all you ask us to do is to pray and to thank you for the miracles that you seek to unfold. We pray, Father, that we'll be part of those miracles with our loving concern and prayers and helping hand. How glad we are to pray for America, wherever we are. What a blessing it is to live in this country. But Father, as we watch things unravel, we know that you want us to keep praying for our leadership and for our people, to seek after you while our Savior tarries in his return. Thank you for raising up ministries like Ranch Hope. We're glad that you're bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to those boys that you love and who are in need of help. Be with their staff, the staff and the caretakers, and all who reside there, that you will be glorified, souls will be won to Jesus Christ, and lives will be changed. Now continue to speak to us in a personal way as we give you praise and thank you for being God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Hear our prayer, for we offer it by faith with complete trust, and offer it in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray that which we now gladly pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will you stand and sing with me this next sweet hymn, 583. 583, let's stand and sing in the garden together. Shall we stand and sing together, please?
Thank you.
seated. When we receive our regular offering, you hear me use the phrase, "Let us now receive our tithes, our gifts, and our offering." The tithe is what God calls every believer to give to the Lord's work. The gift is to be given by those who are visiting in a church family. The offering is above and beyond our tithe as a church family. And that's what the fellowship offering is, above and beyond the tithe. And this enables our board of elders and myself to help people in legitimate need. If your desire is to give that kind of offering prayerfully and lovingly, we will receive our fellowship offering at this time. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you do call us to share your blessings with those who are in need. And these gifts are presented for that purpose. Will you bless them, Heavenly Father, as we dedicate them to you in the name of Jesus Christ. And again, all believers joined and said together, Amen. Now let's meet together in God's infallible word as it is recorded in the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, chapter 1. Easy enough to follow and to find. This John, the writer of this Gospel, is the same John whom God perfectly inspired to write those three powerful letters in the New Testament called 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And the book of Revelation, which is in another amazing passage of book in God's Word. Here in chapter 1, verses 11 to 13, it's not the words of Jesus Christ, it's John the Baptist proclaiming who Jesus Christ is. And for the seeker who is trying to discover who Jesus Christ is, the Gospel of John is a marvelous portion of Scripture for a seeker to read because it explains clearly who Jesus Christ is, why he came, why he's alive, and why he is coming again. For the new believer who doesn't know anything about the Christian doctrines, the Gospel of John is also a marvelous passage of book in the Bible to begin studying God's Word. And then for the believer, those of us who are seasoned at following Jesus Christ, this Gospel of John is also very inspiring to know and to read for ourselves. Having said all that, will you read or listen with your ears to the Gospel of John, chapter 1, beginning in verse 11. He, meaning Jesus Christ, he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. May God add his blessing upon this reading of his holy word. Will you pray with me again? Heavenly Father, we thank you that your word is truly inerrant, without error, infallible, in perfection. And as we open your word in your presence, Father, we humbly ask for God the Holy Spirit to quicken our minds and our hearts in response to your word in a life-changing way. For anyone within the sound of this voice, watching by television or over the internet, or even sitting in this place of worship or in other areas of our facility, who may not know Jesus Christ as his or her Savior, we pray earnestly and sincerely for the salvation of that soul that you love so very much. Lift us up, Heavenly Father. Change us as however you see need to do that. In the precious saving name, we pray together. And again, all believers joined and said together, amen. I try to be as creative as I can with titles of sermons, sometimes successfully and sometimes maybe not so successfully, depending on the opinion of you folks. But when a sermon title comes right out of the pages, right off the pages of God's Word, it's got to be a good title. Children of God, as it is found in verse 12 of John chapter 1. I try to be creative in the outlines to the sermons, sometimes successfully, sometimes not so much. But when an outline of a sermon comes right off the pages of God's Word, it's got to be effective. So here in verse 13, we find out what God said is a definition of a child of God. Every human being who has ever lived on the face of this planet is a creation of God, but not every human being is a child of God. You hear that phrase used often, well, we're all God's children. No, that is not true. We're all God's creation, but you only become a child of God by God. So as we share the Lord's Supper together, this is just a reminder of where we believers came from, by God himself, so that we can give God a fresh thank you for saving our souls and making us whole. Billy Graham said many, many years ago something that I heartily agree with, and that is, the largest mission field in all the world is the organized church. The largest mission field in the world is not unbelievers. It's really people in churches every Sunday who think they're believers because they're in church. Hard for me to believe, but it's true. There are people who think that they're Christians because they're not Jewish, or because they're not a Muslim, so I guess I'm a Christian. Or yes, I must be a Christian because I was baptized as an infant, or because I go to church, or because I try to be a good person. If I were to ask you, are you a believer, and you say yes, and then I ask you, why do you say you're a believer? If you tell me any other answer other than I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, then you may be a good person, you may be a church attender, you may think you're a believer, but in God's eyes, you're not. Now don't get mad at me, don't send me text messages and email, because that's what Jesus Christ said. In John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus Christ encountered a religious man by the name of Nicodemus, who was not just a good man, he was that. He was a religious leader. He was a temple goer all the time. He knew the law inside and outside. Families would say to their children, you need to be like Nicodemus. He's a good man. He's a religious leader. And yet to this good man, this religious leader, Jesus Christ said to him, Nicodemus, you must be born again. The only way to become a child of God is to become born again with the Holy Spirit. Now, I've been born again with the Holy Spirit for over 55 years. And the only reason I am born again is because I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I've been obedient to Jesus Christ, who said to me, as he says to every person, you must be born again. So we see in verse 13 of John chapter 1, who is not a child of God? You're not a child of God by human blood. I had godly parents who were very involved in the church. But had I died without Jesus Christ, I would be in hell today, even though I had godly parents and I was the product of their blood, the blood of godly parents. Billy Graham and his wife have children and grandchildren. Not one of them will be in heaven because of Billy Graham and his wife, who is now with the Lord. So it's not a blood. In verse 13, you can see that. Children of God, not of blood, in verse 13. Nor of the will of the flesh. You can't decide, I want to be born again by doing good works. No one is saved by doing good works. We are saved to do good works, but not to be saved by doing good works. So God wants us to help people. God wants us to do good works. God wants us to be law-abiding. God wants us to be obedient to his word. But none of that results in salvation. You can be baptized every single day. You can live in a baptismal pool. Every moment of every day will bring you food or whatever. But you won't be any more saved than those who were not baptized. The thief on the cross was not baptized. He was not a good man. He didn't do good works. The thief on the cross was not a guy that just stole some candy bars at the local store. He was a murderer and a thief. And yet when he cried out to Jesus Christ by faith, put his faith in Jesus Christ as Savior, Jesus Christ said to that thief who was not baptized, you shall be in heaven with me. So being a child of God is not of human blood, no matter how good your parents were. It's not of doing good works, no matter how important they are. And thirdly, in verse 13, it's not by the will of man. It's not by someone else. I can't save you. I can invite you to be saved. I can't save anyone. I know some pastors who brag about how many people they've saved. And I will get in their face and I say, you haven't saved a soul in your life and you never will. Neither have I. Only God saves souls. You point them in the right direction, but you can't take credit for saving souls. Only Jesus Christ saves souls. So it's not like we can pray people into heaven. So it's not of the will of man. In verse 13, however, it is only by God. God loves every soul that's been created. God wants every soul to be saved. But it's a matter of freedom of choice to reject Christ or to accept Christ. If you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, as you share the Lord's Supper today, then you ought to be coming with an attitude of renewed thankfulness. I can't tell you how many times in 55 years of being saved I have thanked the Lord for my salvation. Couldn't begin to number how many times, but every time I do, again, it's like I never did before. That's what God wants from our hearts. In John chapter 1, verse 13, it is by God. Titus chapter 3, verse 5, Jesus Christ saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and the renewing by the Holy Spirit. That's how you become a child of God. So this story is told of a 10-year-old at the church whose father was the pastor of the church, and they were walking home together after a Sunday morning service, and the 10-year-old boy said, "Dad, I really liked your sermon today." And so the preacher's father said, "Well, son, what was the sermon all about?" And the son says, "Well, you taught us about Andrew bringing his brother to the Lord. And then you challenged us to bring someone else to the Lord." And the father preacher said, "You're right, son, exactly. Have you decided who you're going to bring to the Lord?" And the little boy paused and thought for a moment, and he said, "Yes, I have. I decided to bring myself." That is what salvation is all about. It's bringing yourself to Jesus Christ. So if you've never done that before, here, watching by television or over the internet, don't forget, 74 countries, we are literally watched. So we need to pray for souls to get saved, whoever comes into contact of our ministry. But that's what they need to do, bring themselves to Jesus Christ and be saved. Then they can become one of God's children. You say, "Well, Pastor, I've been saved for years, like you." Then I invite you to join me as we share the Lord's Supper this morning and just come with fresh thank you. Fresh, out of the box, untouched, unused gratefulness. "God, I thank you again for saving my soul and making me whole. Thank you, God, that it is only by your grace that I am saved. Thank you, God, for my salvation this day in and through Jesus Christ. How honored, how pleased, how humbled I am to be numbered amongst your children of God through Jesus Christ." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you so much that it's not of our doing. We are such boasters in our own way about whatever it is that we're so proud of in our lives. But we can't boast about our salvation except in and through Jesus Christ. So we thank you, Heavenly Father, that in and through Jesus Christ we're numbered amongst the children of God. Not just for today, but forever. So we need to pause and thank you again for being our Savior. And we pray again for anyone who does not yet know Jesus Christ as his or her Savior, that they'll stop resisting, stop running, stop rejecting Jesus Christ, and come by faith and be saved today, so that they too can be numbered amongst the children of God for all eternity. Hear our prayer, for we offer it by faith with complete trust in the loving and precious name of Jesus Christ. And once again, all believers joined and said together, Amen. While Laurie plays for us, we'll ask you to enter into an attitude of prayer. Think about your personal relationship with Jesus Christ as we share the Lord's Supper together. As you continue to pray before the Lord, I remind you that this is indeed the Lord's Supper, which he himself instituted so that disciples, believers like us, might come together in obedience to his command to come and share the Lord's Supper together. You do not need to be a member of this church in order to share the Lord's Supper with us, but you must personally proclaim Jesus Christ as your Savior. The elders nor I will pass that judgment upon you. If you do not proclaim Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then I issue to you this very severe warning. It comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. If you have invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior, then you are cordially invited to share the Lord's Supper with us. I continue to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I have received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Elder Prezzetti is going to come and lead us in our prayer of thanksgiving.
Oh, heavenly, most gracious Father, we thank you for the gift of eternal salvation, that your Son gave us that opportunity by willingly sacrificing his body on the cross. As we now partake of the bread, which represents his body, let us remember that he loves us and will be with us always. Oh, Heavenly Father, we pray for the endurance to, at this time, for pain and suffering. Help us to have the peace and the comfort and the strength to endure. We ask this through the holy and precious name of your living Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
loving remembrance of the body of Jesus Christ, which suffered and died as a sinless sacrifice for our sins. Let's partake of this bread together. Continuing to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. In the same way, he also took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it to remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Elder Keller is going to come and lead us in a prayer of thanksgiving.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, such amazing love you have for us that you would allow your Son to go through unspeakable horror, pain, suffering for us that are so unworthy. Yet, Lord, because of the shed blood of Jesus, we can realize your salvation by accepting Jesus' sacrifice. And Lord, for this, we give you praise forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
In loving remembrance of the blood of Jesus Christ, which was shed for the remission of our sins, let us partake of this cup together. If you desire to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, or to be baptized by immersion, we do have some adults and young people that desire to be baptized in that way, or desire to come forward for any reason, you're welcome to do that. And we stand and sing prayerfully and thoughtfully unto the Lord, 273, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior." Shall we stand and sing together, please? You come as we sing.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
this place of worship. We thank you for honoring us with your presence. We're so thankful that your presence is not left behind, but wherever we go, you are there with us. As God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, may we leave here rejoicing with our words and with our hearts, that because Jesus Christ is alive, the best is yet to come. Amen and amen.